All right, so tonight we're going to begin with the second week. Each of the eight lessons has a separate topic, a separate title. So you see, the topic for tonight is rotations and revolutions. We'll talk more about that in just a second. By way of introduction, though, for those that might not have been able to be here with us last week, we covered kind of an introduction to biblical cosmology. Cosmology is the study of the universe, how God made it, how it all fits together. We will be talking about things from the Bible regarding the sun, the moon, the stars, the earth, how it all fits together, and how it all works together. As I said at the beginning last week, there will definitely be some things that are going to be totally new, I would think, to everyone that's here. Now, having said that, I want to say this. Remember the verses that we looked at last week as we were beginning our study, how that the Bible says, first of all, he that answereth a matter without hearing it, the Bible says it is a folly and shame unto him. So just because something is presented that you haven't seen before, or something that is presented that is totally different than everything you were taught in school, don't automatically discount it as being true. We started our study last week by looking at some of the different lies that modern science, atheists, and evolution teach on a regular basis in our schools, in our young people's textbooks. And we looked at those things and saw the things that probably most of us already know are lies. They're false. There's no science to it. We're told these things are true, but there's no evidence for it. It's a theory, and it's called theory for a reason. Of course, we're talking about the Big Bang. We talked about evolution and the origin of life. We talked about the origin of human life. And we looked at some of those things from Genesis chapter 1 last week, that for a Bible-believing Christian, we're either going to believe Genesis chapter 1 or something else. There's no way that you can believe what modern science says about these things and also believe Genesis chapter 1. One or the other is true, or at least if Genesis is not true, something else is true. So it's important as we go through here that we all keep in mind that the things we're going to see in this study, not just from last week, but every single night of this study, you're going to be confronted with things that I'm going to go ahead and tell you now. I'm going to promise you they are going to contradict things that you were taught in science class at school. They're going to contradict things that you have been told and have believed your entire life. They're things from the Bible, though. What I want to encourage you to do, what I want to beg you to do as your pastor, is to look at everything from the lens of Scripture. Whatever the Bible says, that's the truth. It doesn't matter if that's what you and I have been taught. If the Bible says it, it's still the truth. It doesn't matter if we have the ability to totally understand it all or not. If the Bible says it, we have to believe it by faith. The ramifications for not believing it are, well, if one part of the Bible is false, how do you know what other parts of the Bible are false? You either believe the Bible is God's Word or you don't. And if you believe that the Bible is wrong on these areas of science and cosmology, well, hey, all you've done is put yourself or some scientist as the final arbiter of what's right and what's wrong in the Bible. That's a very dangerous place for any person to put themselves, to put man as the final authority. So whatever the Bible says, let's just believe it so. And as we go through tonight and in the weeks to follow, when you encounter things that you've never seen before out of the Bible, and you encounter things that you've not believed your whole life, don't discount it just because you've never been confronted with it before. Don't discount it just because it contradicts what you were taught in science class from first grade on. Look at it through the lens of Scripture. Pray and ask God to help you to believe by faith the things about science that are in the Bible, just like you believe the things you believe in the Bible about theology. Because it's all the Word of God. God would not tell us something that is not true. Having said that, there are all the disclaimers out of the way. Let's dig in tonight. Tonight our study is Biblical Cosmology Part 2, Rotations and Revolutions. We looked at six lies of evolutionists, atheists, last week. Tonight we're going to begin with lie number 7. We're only going to look at two tonight, by the way, but we're going to spend more time on these two. The first one is the rotation of the earth. Modern science says the earth is spinning on its axis at a slight tilt, making one revolution every 24 hours, which produces day and night shifts. NASA states that the earth is approximately 25,000 miles in circumference, that is around, at the equator, which means that the earth is constantly spinning at approximately 1,000 miles per hour. So in other words, if the earth is the size NASA says it is, 25,000 miles in circumference at the equator, in order to make one rotation, every 24 hours, at the equator, the earth is spinning 1,000 miles an hour. Now, what does the Bible say? The Bible says that the earth does not spin at all, but rather the sun makes a circuit above the earth, creating the day-night phenomenon. Now, before I change slides to the next slide, already in the first slide tonight, you're presented with something that is totally different than what you were taught in science class. It's totally different than what I was taught in science class. We're going to look in just a moment what not only the Bible says, but what does evidence itself that you can see, hear, taste, and smell with your senses. What does it say? Modern science says that it is that rotation of the earth that produces days and nights. That as the ball of the earth spins, when one side of it is facing the sun, that produces day. When the side that is facing away from the sun is dark, that produces night. However, you and I all also already know from what we looked at in Genesis chapter 1 last week, there were already day and night before there was a sun. We also saw that there was light before there was a sun. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. The Bible says, God said, let there be light, and there was light. That was on day one of creation. The sun was not created until what day of creation? Day four, that's right. So days and nights already existed before the sun existed. Now, let's continue on and see what the Bible has to say about the earth spinning. Already, your mind is thinking. I hope you're taking notes and writing down questions if you have them. We'll come back to them at the end. Before we look at the verses in the Bible about whether the earth spins or not, look at this slide, the biblical dilemma. It used to really bother me that there were a couple of stories in the Bible that seemed utterly impossible based upon what we were taught in science class at school. These are stories out of the Bible. Sure, God can do anything. He's the creator after all. But what would be the consequences of suspending His own laws of physics? Here are the two examples that always bothered me. Now, these are two stories from the Old Testament. Maybe you're already familiar with them. Maybe not. Let's look at the two of them. The first one is the story in the Old Testament of the sun standing still while Joshua finished mopping up the enemy in a battle. You've all hopefully heard the story at some point growing up of the sun standing still so that there was daylight enough for Joshua to finish winning the battle before darkness fell. The second story that is always, when I was growing up, bothered me because it just didn't seem how it could make sense based on what we were taught about the earth spinning on its axis. And that is, the sundial turned backwards for King Hezekiah as a sign. That is, the shadow on the sundial literally went backwards. That was their clock, of course, at the time, the sundial. It went backwards. What would have to happen with a spinning ball for the sundial to go backwards? Well, the earth would have to not only stop, it would have to reverse course, and then it would have to, when it started back normal again, it'd have to go back forward again. Now, I want you to think for a moment, anything spinning 1,000 miles per hour, think about that. Try stopping something spinning 1,000 miles per hour abruptly and see what happens to everything sitting on it. Can you imagine a ball or anything else that's spinning 1,000 miles an hour in this direction and all of a sudden, it comes to a stop? What would happen to everything on the ball? Why, it would either fall off or probably fly off in all directions. But with the sundial, it's not just a matter of something spinning 1,000 miles per hour and then coming to a screeching halt, but it's something spinning 1,000 miles per hour and then not only coming to a halt, but reversing course and then starting back up again 1,000 miles per hour. Still don't get it? Try throwing your car's transmission into reverse while you're only traveling 70 miles an hour and see what happens. Actually, don't try that. But you get the point. If you're going down the expressway 70 miles an hour and you slam it into reverse, there probably aren't going to be any pieces of the transmission or you to pick up afterwards. Definitely not the transmission. I don't think even Alex would want to put that back together. So you can imagine if there was a ball spinning 1,000 miles per hour and it ground to an immediate halt and then went backwards and then began to spin again. Now, as a boy growing up, I was just an average kid, but the thought occurred to me more than once with these two Bible stories, how in the world could that happen and every person on the earth not go flying off the earth? God is God. He created everything. He made the laws of physics. Certainly God can suspend the laws of physics if He chooses to. We know He could do that. But what would be the implications of that? What if there were just a simpler answer, a simpler solution than the fact of Him having to suspend the laws of physics that He created? What if the earth, in fact, just wasn't spinning at all? This is the story of the day the earth stood still. This is not a reference to the classic 1951 science fiction movie by the same title. And if you're my age or older, you probably remember that old science fiction movie, The Day the Earth Stood Still. But if you believe the fairy tale of modern science, it means that the earth is spinning 1,000 miles per hour would have to have immediately come to a stop for Joshua. Here's what the Bible says in Joshua 10. Then spake Joshua to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel. And he said in the sight of Israel, Sun, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou moon in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed, until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is not this written in the book of Joshua? So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven and hasted not to go down about a whole day. That means for almost a whole extra day's amount of time, the sun just stayed in the same place. And there was no day like that before it or after it, that the Lord hearkened unto the voice of a man, for the Lord fought for Israel. But notice what it says at the bottom. But the Bible doesn't say that the earth stood still. It says that the sun stood still. Now, just like you probably growing up, I was told in Sunday school class, whenever we got to this Bible story, well, that was just that's just the view of humans looking at things, that the sun stood still. But that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says the sun stood still. It doesn't say that the earth stood still. That is, if the ball earth was spinning at the rate of 1,000 miles per hour, and it needed to stay sun long enough for Joshua to finish winning this battle, the earth would have had to have come to a halt and stayed here almost the entire length of a day for him to finish this battle before it started up again. But it doesn't say that the earth stood still. Instead, it says that the sun stood still. That the earth, in fact, was not moving. The sun was moving, not the earth. All right, here's the next story. The shadows on the clock go backwards. This is, of course, talking about the sundial in the story with Hezekiah. The story of Hezekiah, who asked God for an extra 15 years to live, as recorded in Isaiah 38. He asked God for a sign that God was really going to do it for him. So here's what God did. Verse 7 says, "This shall be a sign unto thee from the Lord, that the Lord will do this thing that he hath spoken. Behold, I will bring again the shadow of the degrees, which is gone down in the sundial of Ahaz, 10 degrees backward." So the sun returned 10 degrees by which it was gone down. That means that the shadow on the sundial that goes around as the day goes along, God literally moved the shadow backwards 10 degrees. For the shadow on the sundial to have to go backwards, it means one of two things happened. If you believe what modern science tells us, it means that the spinning ball, spinning 1,000 miles per hour, stopped, went backwards, and then started again. Again, you think about that illustration of a transmission going 70 miles an hour, and then think about something stopping in its tracks going 1,000 miles per hour, going backwards, and then reversing course 1,000 miles per hour again. You either have to believe that, or you can believe simply what the Bible says, that the earth was still, the sun was going around and above the earth, and the sun stood still, went back 10 degrees, and then started going forward again. Either the earth reversed course or the sun reversed course. Again, God can do either one, but the Bible doesn't say that the earth reversed course. It says that the sun returned 10 degrees. According to NASA's version of science, falsely so called, which Paul calls it in the New Testament, this means that the earth would not have only stopped spinning 1,000 miles per hour all of a sudden, but would have spun backwards before then changing direction again and spinning forwards. I don't have to remind you again what would happen to something spinning 1,000 miles per hour if it reversed course. Everything on it, everyone on it, would have gone hurtling into space. But what does the Bible say about the earth spinning? What does the Bible say? Does the earth spin, or does the sun move in a circuit above and around the earth? Read it for yourself what the Bible says in Psalm 19, 1 through 6. "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. Day unto day uttereth speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard." That is the glory of the heavens. "Their line is gone out throughout all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them hath he set a tabernacle for the sun, which is a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoiceth as a strong man to run a race. His going forth is from the end of the heaven, and his circuit unto the ends of it. And there is nothing hid from the heat thereof. This passage in Psalms plainly teaches that it is the sun that is moving in a circuit above and around the earth. It's not the earth moving, but it's the sun moving. The word circuit literally means a circle or a compass. It's the same word translated circuit here that we would translate into the word circle or compass, as in to encompass something. A preacher, this is totally different than what I have been taught my entire life. You're saying that the Bible says that the earth does not spin. That's exactly what the preacher's saying. That's what the Bible is saying. Now, I'm going to say this before I go any further. This and the other things we've already seen in the Bible about cosmology, and the things that we haven't even seen yet that contradict the things you've been taught, I know they're not going to be easy for you to know what to deal with up here between your two ears with that gray matter up here. Because what you're seeing from the Bible totally contradicts what you were taught in science class. There's a big fancy name for it that psychologists use. It's called cognitive dissonance. That is, anytime we are confronted with something that seems to be obviously true, but it contradicts what we've believed our whole lives, it's hard for us to accept it, even if it's true. And our minds will go to every possible avenue to excuse whatever it is, to explain away whatever it is, rather than accept it, because it contradicts everything we were taught about that particular thing before. I understand that. I've been where you're sitting right now. But about 5 years ago, it had really bothered me about some of the things that we're reading here my whole life growing up. I grew up in a Christian home, grew up in a Christian school, went to Sunday school class my whole life, then went to Bible college. And I can remember asking Sunday school teachers, Christian school teachers, and Bible college professors some of the questions about these things that just didn't seem to add up with what we were told in school. And the usual answer that I got was, well, they were just explaining things from the way they were perceived on earth by men. But that's not what the Bible is. The Bible is not giving us man's perspective on things. The Bible is God's perspective on things. You can see that from the beginning to the end of the Bible. But about 5 years ago, I came to the decision personally. I didn't share it, I don't think, with anyone but my son at the time, that I was just going to believe the Bible for what it says. So about 5 years ago, I came to my personal acceptance of the fact that the earth is not a spinning ball. It is not spinning. It is the sun that's moving around the earth, because that's what the Bible says. But we're not finished tonight. Let's continue. More scripture on the subject. Does the earth move or does the sun move? As fundamental Bible-believing Baptists, we always say that readers should take the Bible literally unless it tells us to do otherwise. Why have we been taught then to not take these passages we're about to look at about the sun literally? Read them for yourself and take them for what they say. We'll go through them just quickly, but look what the Bible says about the sun. Habakkuk 3:11, the sun and moon stood still in their habitation. Genesis 15:12, the sun was going down. Numbers 2 and 3, the rising of the sun. Judges 5:31, the sun when he goeth forth in his might. 2 Samuel 23:4, when the sun riseth. Psalm 113:3, from the rising of the sun unto the going down of the same, the Lord's name is to be praised. Ecclesiastes 1:5, the sun also ariseth, and the sun goeth down, and hasteth to his place where he arose. In other words, he's making a circuit. The Bible teaches the sun is making a circuit above slash around the earth. It does not teach that the earth is spinning. It teaches that the earth is still and the sun is moving around the earth. That's totally different than what we're taught. What we're taught in science class from the time we're able to have science class is that everything revolves around the sun. But wait a minute. Isn't that the same thing that we've been told by Mystery Babylon religion all the way back to the Tower of Babel? Everything revolves around the sun, which is the embodiment of Nimrod, who is none other but a symbol for Satan and the worship of Satan and the coming false religion of the Antichrist. Everything in Mystery Babylon religion is always about the sun. All of those ancient religions that are pagan religions, that's why it's all about sun worship. Everywhere you go on the earth, there's a sun god and a moon goddess. It's why the Catholic Church, which is a part of Mystery Babylon, has the sunburst in their observance of communion and all their other observations as well. There are dozens more verses just like these. The sun either rises or it doesn't. The sun either goes down or it doesn't. Is it the sun that rises or the earth that spins? What does the Bible say? Well, preacher, I'm not totally convinced. All I'm asking you to do is look at what the Bible says. A very simple solution. Both of our troublesome events in Scripture have a very simple solution once we accept what the Bible literally says. The story of Joshua and the day the sun stood still, that's not really hard to believe when you realize that the Bible, if you just believe the Bible for what it says, that the sun is moving and the sun stood still. If the sun stood still, it doesn't require God holding everybody and everything on a spinning earth that's spinning at 1,000 miles an hour. The story of Hezekiah and the sundial going backwards. Well, if you believe that it's the sun that's moving and not the earth, it doesn't require a whole lot for God to just take that sun up in the sky, back it up a little bit, and start it back going again. The earth doesn't have to stop moving. It doesn't have to stop spinning. It doesn't have to throw everything here, there, and yon. And it doesn't have to require God to violate His laws of physics to hold everything on the earth. Could He do that? Yes, He could do that. But it's not what it says He did do. The Bible says He stopped the sun, not the earth. Suddenly, the cataclysmic results from the earth suddenly stopping it spinning 1,000 miles per hour and reversing course are unnecessary when we just accept that the earth was never spinning in the first place. Rather, the sun and the moon are traveling above and around the earth in a circuit, just as described in the Word of God. And of course, the creator of the heaven and the earth could have stopped the earth from spinning and held everything in place if he had wished. But there was no need since it was never spinning to begin with. For the first, mankind is about 6,000 years old. For the first 5,500 years of human history, every civilization on the earth believed that the earth was still, and it was the sun and the moon and all the things in the heavens that were traveling in a circuit around the earth. It's only been 500 years ago that man started believing something different. The Bible teaches the earth is still. The Bible teaches the sun and the moon are moving around the earth, not the earth moving around the sun. The ancient Hebrews, to whom God gave the book of Genesis, Moses, who recorded the book of Genesis, did not believe that the earth was moving. King David did not believe the earth was moving when he penned the words in the Psalms. Preacher, I can't believe you're saying that the earth is not spinning. NASA says it is. They tell us that it is. The astronauts say that it is. The cosmonauts say that it is. Yeah, but that's not what the Bible says. They say a lot of other things in Washington that I don't believe too. But that's for another lesson. Lie number 8. The orbit of the earth. Modern science says the earth is orbiting the sun, which is at the center of the solar system. By the way, it's also the center of worship by the Illuminists, those who worship the sun in one variety or another. And they say the earth is orbiting the sun in an ellipse at 66,600 miles per hour. You can make what you want to of the speed they say that it's traveling, but it seems a little ironic that the speed it's supposedly orbiting the sun just happens to start with 666. But what does the Bible say? The Bible says the earth is stationary and does not move. A preacher, I kind of see where you were going with the spinning on its axis and the sun standing still. I still think that's just man's perspective of it all. The Bible does not say plainly the earth is still. You haven't shown us any verses that say that. But the Bible says that. 1 Chronicles 16:30. Fear before him all the earth. The world also shall be stable that it be not moved. Psalm 33:8-9. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For he spake and it was done. He commanded and it stood fast. That is the earth. Psalm 93:1. The Lord reigneth. He is clothed with majesty. The Lord is clothed with strength, wherewith he hath girded himself. The world also is established that it cannot be moved. Psalm 96:10. Say among the heathen that the Lord reigneth. The world also shall be established that it shall not be moved. Psalm 104:5. Who laid the foundations of the earth that it should not be removed forever. Preacher, the Bible doesn't say the earth doesn't move. Here are just a few of the verses that say that it does not move. Totally different than what you and I were taught in third grade, fourth grade, ninth grade, and college science class. But the Bible says the earth does not move. But modern science has created a cosmology for the last 500 years that totally goes against the cosmology that every human society believed for the first 5,500 years of human existence, including the Bible. Preacher, why would they even say that it moves if it doesn't move? Notice that the focus in modern cosmology is not on the earth. In fact, the focus on modern cosmology is to make the earth not important. In the biblical model, the earth is the center of everything. There's a reason for that. But in modern cosmology, the goal is to make the earth insignificant, not important at all. Because if the earth, of all the whatever there is out there, if the earth is the center of it all, that means it didn't just happen that way. There's a reason that it's that way. What does the Bible say? A preponderance of evidence. The question, how many verses in the Bible talk about the sun, the moon, and the stars moving? More than 50. We only looked at a few of them. The next question, how many verses in the Bible talk about the earth moving? None. There are no verses that talk about the earth moving. In fact, the verses you just saw say the earth is still, motionless, does not move. And another thing, modern science says that the earth was created and spun off by the sun, and so it began to circle the sun, whose gravity keeps it in orbit. Notice that that everything revolves around the solar deity to the Illuminist. Everything is about the sun to those that want to make the earth move. But it's hard to understand how the earth could be circling something that wasn't even created until day four. You see, those who are telling you that the earth circles the sun are telling you that because they don't believe the biblical account anyway. They don't believe that the earth was created on day one of six literal days of creation, and that the sun, the moon, and the stars were created on day four. They don't believe that anyway. They teach that the sun came into existence from the Big Bang, and that it, after time, slung off the earth as some kind of residual matter. And that when it slung off the earth got caught up in some kind of a orbit around the sun. But if you believe that, you can't believe what Genesis chapter 1 says. Because Genesis 1 says there was no sun when the earth was created. Well, preacher, I believe the Bible, but I don't believe that the earth is motionless. I don't believe that the sun is going around the earth. I believe the earth is going around the sun, just like we've been taught. You can go there, but if you don't believe that God created the earth on the first day and created the sun, the moon, and the stars on the fourth day, you're going to have some big problems when you come to what the Bible says about how you're supposed to be saved too, I think. Geocentrism versus heliocentrism. Modern science says the sun is at the center of the solar system, and all of the planets revolve around it. This is called heliocentrism and was not widely believed by anyone until about 500 years ago. It is also known as the Copernican system, named for Nicholas Copernicus, a Jesuit astronomer credited with changing the scientific community. Now, I'll say a word about the Jesuits before we move on. The Jesuits are a group of Roman Catholics that were created during the time of the Protestant Reformation. The Jesuits are the militant arm of the Roman Catholic Church. They were specifically created to fight Protestantism, to stop those people that were leaving the Catholic Church, to force them back into the Catholic Church by any way they could. Jesuits today run many of the major universities in America and all across the world. The U.S. Supreme Court is primarily today made up of Jews or Jesuits. You can look it up for yourself and see which are which. Jesuits are in the highest places of government and academia and science everywhere around the world on purpose, because they are pushing a religious agenda to undermine Scripture and to introduce a different religion to mankind. It's not about science. It's all about a religion. The Bible says the earth is stationary and the sun and moon move in a circuit above and around it. This is called geocentrism. That is, the earth is the center, and was the belief held universally among mankind for the first 5,500 years of human history. It's also known as the Ptolemaic system, named for the astronomer of the second century who put the ancient belief into a formal system. This is a picture I stole off the internet, but the one on the left is geocentrism. It has the earth at the center. The one on the right is heliocentrism, with the sun at the center of the solar system. The one on the right, of course, is what you're taught in science class. But the one on the left is what the Bible says. Geocentrism or heliocentrism. Here's a little more information about the cult of heliocentrism and how this idea that the earth is moving and the sun is the center of the solar system and universe came into existence 500 years ago, when it was not believed by hardly anyone for the first 5,500 years of human history. Geocentrism was universally held in some form among every culture the first 5,500 years. But in 1543, Roman Catholic astronomer Nicholas Copernicus broke with history, science, and the Bible to put forth his theory of heliocentrism, that the sun is the center of the solar system. In 1600, just a few years later, Danish astronomer Tycho Brahe used observations that he made of the heavenly bodies to validate the Ptolemaic system of geocentrism. And he said that everything in the heavens revolved around the earth, not the sun. He was the most respected astronomer of his day. Something interesting happened, though, when he began to publish his findings. There was another astronomer with Jesuit connections that requested to become his assistant. His name was Johannes Kepler. He began working with Brahe. He was Brahe's assistant, but was strongly influenced by the Jesuits. Less than a year later, Tycho Brahe fell over dead under mysterious circumstances. And all of his information that he had recorded for years and years, proving geocentrism, was now in the hands of Kepler. You'll remember Kepler. He is the one who came up with the notion that is taught in science books today, that the earth and all the other planets in the solar system revolve around the sun. And not only that they revolve around the sun, but instead of revolving in circles around the sun, they revolve in ellipticals, elliptical orbits around the sun, oblong circles. He stole Brahe's life work and claimed that Brahe was wrong, that all the numbers actually showed that they supported heliocentrism instead of geocentrism. By the way, there have been books and I think even movies made about the mystery surrounding the death of Tycho Brahe and Kepler's involvement. In 1609, just 8 years later, the famous or infamous Catholic scientist Galileo, the one that you were told invented the telescope, came to the defense of Kepler, a fellow Catholic, with the support of the Jesuits, and claimed to have used his telescope to have corroborated Kepler and heliocentrism. So after 55 years of human history, all of a sudden now, with the Jesuits on the scene, the Jesuits who had been on the scene literally at the time that this started with Copernicus, all of a sudden now the Jesuits have introduced a brand new view of cosmology to the world that no one believed before that. From 1600 to the present, Jesuits and numerous secret societies have consistently advanced the theory of heliocentrism to advance their larger agenda of illuminism, the worship of the sun, and the coming religion of Mystery Babylon. But there's some big problems for heliocentrism. Some big problems for believing that the sun is the center of the solar system and not the earth. Some explanation had to be devised by the proponents of heliocentrism to explain how and why the earth and all the planets circled the sun as Kepler and Copernicus contended. What would make the earth and the planets magically keep circling the sun if they in fact do that? Then there was also the second problem as to how to explain the question that had gone unanswered for too long since Copernicus. How do things stick magically to a ball that's spinning 1,000 miles per hour and hurtling along through space around the sun at 66,600 miles per hour without falling off or better yet being flung off? How can you explain either of those two things? There had to be some new thing introduced to make the theory work. So heliocentrism is a theory. But they couldn't explain it with the natural laws of science, so they're going to create a new theory to prop up this theory. Enter Master Mason Sir Isaac Newton, high priest of the occult world of Illuminism. Now, I want to say this. Isaac Newton was a Mason. Quite a quite a while back, I did a study on the history and origin of Freemasonry. I have friends, you have friends that are Masons. The average Mason does not know the things I presented in that study and does not know the things that I hope to present in a future study. The average Mason doesn't know those things. The average Mason is in the first 3 degrees of Masonry in the Blue Lodge. The average Freemason, as we saw from the writings of those who wrote the 33rd degree and lower, they intentionally deceive the initiates in the lower levels. They say that they are intentionally deceived. So I'm not saying that the people you know in your neighborhood that are Masons know any of what we're talking about, are involved in what we're talking about. But there are high-level Masons who are not just Masons. They're Jesuits, and many of them are involved in the occult and Luciferianism as well. The High Priest of Illuminism. Isaac Newton was born about a decade after the death of Johannes Kepler, who had breathed life into the new theory of heliocentrism put forth by a collection of Freemasons and Jesuits. Newton is most notably remembered for his law of gravity, which miraculously solved at one time two of the biggest problems that the new science had encountered. How does everything revolve around the sun and keep going? And secondly of all, how does everything not fly off the earth as it's spinning 1,000 miles per hour? The only problem is that his law has never been proven, that is gravity, and cannot be reproduced by any scientific experimentation. He and the other Illuminists insist that it must be accepted simply because it has to be. Honest physicists, even today, still refuse to accept the concept of gravity. But before we consider more closely the law of gravity, what about the man who was called in to save the day for heliocentrism and modern science? We're going to look in just a moment at the man, who he was, what he believed, and what his motives were. But let me say this about gravity. No scientist has ever proven that gravity exists. Many of the foremost scientists and physicists in his day and today do not believe that there's such a thing as gravity. Well, preacher, we're here on the earth. We're not floating away. That doesn't mean there's such a thing as gravity. We'll talk about that later, but the theory of gravity was created to prop up the theory that everything is revolving around the earth. No one ever believed in any such thing until then. Isaac Newton came up with the theory not because an apple fell and innocently hit him on the head. Isaac Newton devised the theory of gravity because he was looking for some way to support heliocentrism and the earth spinning around the sun. Isaac Newton is often referred to as a Christian by people that write about him. But he vehemently denied the doctrine of the Trinity and the deity of Christ. If you don't believe Jesus is God, you're not a Christian. So he might be called a Christian, but he was not a Christian. He questioned the inerrancy of portions of the Bible with which he did not agree, including 1 John 5:7, which clearly states the doctrine of the Trinity. By the way, 1 John 5:7 is one of those verses that anytime somebody brings me a new version of the Bible and they want to know, does this line up with the manuscripts that our King James Bible comes from, I say, well, just turn to 1 John 5:7 and see. Because all of the modern versions leave out 1 John 5:7. It's the clearest passage in the Bible about the Trinity. It says there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. He didn't believe that verse or a lot of others in the Bible. He called the God he worshiped the Supreme God and the Universal Ruler, names which sound eerily similar to the references to the God made by the universal religion of Freemasonry. His religious views are most closely aligned with the ancient Gnostics, as is the religion of Freemasonry. I have dear friends that are Masons, but all of them would tell you that Freemasonry is not a religion and does not have a religion. But when you read the writings of those who wrote the rituals of Freemasonry, Albert Pike, Albert Mackey, Manly Hall, the most well-known of all the Masons, they tell you explicitly Freemasonry is a religion. And the religion of Freemasonry is universalism. The belief in any God you want to believe in, call him by any name you want to believe. But Albert Pike says, ultimately, the God of Freemasonry is Luciferianism. Those are Albert Pike's words, who wrote Morals and Dogma. Those are not the preacher's words. In his personal life, Isaac Newton devoted a great deal of time to the practice of alchemy, a study claimed by the Knights Templar to make it possible to turn base metals like lead into gold. Those deeply involved in Freemasonry and Illuminism claim to be able to use alchemy as a code word for transforming the views of mankind into something different and bringing about the initiation into Illuminism of Mystery Babylon. Alchemy is not really about changing metals into gold. It's about changing men's thoughts into something different. He had many close male friends, including the French atheist Voltaire, though he openly stated often that he had no interest in relationships with women, going so far as to have an ongoing dispute with the political philosopher John Locke, who came up with life, liberty, and property, or the pursuit of happiness, for trying to encourage him to court women. He clearly had no interest by his protest. So he had some rather interesting views about things other than just the sun, the moon, the stars, and the earth. He created gravity. This was his theory. This was the theory which he said explained why the earth stays in a circuit around the sun and why things on a spinning ball going 1,000 miles per hour don't fly off. Gravity is a mysterious thing, if you believe it. It's strong enough to hold the oceans, even drops of water, to a spinning ball. And yet it's weak enough that a bird can fly, that a butterfly can fly, to escape its power. It's a mysterious thing. The magic of gravity on water. Somehow we're supposed to believe that the invisible force of gravity not only mysteriously keeps the earth rotating in an oblong elliptical orbit that's not even a circle around the sun, but that it also magically makes the ocean stick to the ball earth. The force of gravity is so strong that it makes water stick to the surface of a ball. Did you get that? Gravity makes water stick to the entire surface of a ball that's spinning at 1,000 miles per hour. On the top, on the bottom, on the sides, all over. But what does water actually do on a spinning ball? Go ahead, think for yourself. You know the answer. If you have water on a spinning ball that's not even going 1,000 miles per hour, what does water do on anything that's spinning? That's water on a spinning ball. But the magic force of gravity that Isaac Newton had to come up with to save the theory of heliocentrism had to claim that the oceans, the ponds, the lakes, they stick to the earth because of gravity. Something that can't be proved, something that modern physicists still argue even exists. But he said, whatever this force is, it even holds the water to the earth. Holds the water to the ball. Well, preacher, that's what we've been told ever since we were kids, that gravity holds the water down. Okay, but have you ever thought about that? Or are you like I was for years and years growing up and I just accepted it because, hey, that's what the science teacher said. And the science teacher was just parroting what the science professor that she had in college said. And he was just parroting what somebody told him. Have you ever thought about that? What's the logic of water sticking to a spinning ball spinning at 1,000 miles per hour. But you see, it has to be if you believe in a spinning ball and you don't believe the Bible when it says the earth is standing still. You have to have some magic force holding it all together, or you have to believe the Bible. But if that wasn't good enough, the absurdity of spinning air. As if water sticking to the surface of a ball spinning at 1,000 miles per hour was not silly enough, the magicians of heliocentricity would also have us to believe that the mystical force of gravity also makes the air stick to the surface of the earth. I bet you probably weren't told that in science class and said, unless some wiseacre raised his hand and asked a question. Teacher, what about the air? Well,
Neil deGrasse Tyson.
Yeah. He, all those other modern astrophysicists will tell you, yeah, the air around the earth, the atmosphere, sticks to the earth because of gravity too. Not just the water, the air. The atmosphere is stuck to the earth with gravity too. That's it. They say the entire earth's atmosphere, miles high, mysteriously sticks to the surface of the earth and spins with it. Why did they say something so ridiculous? Because we all know what would happen with 1,000 mile per hour wind gusts. You see the dog. You would feel it, wouldn't you? Oh yeah, you'd feel it all right.
Kentucky.
That's a good example. Look at Kentucky and the recent tornadoes. You see, in order to make this theory of heliocentrism work, that the earth is revolving around the sun, they had to come up with some magical force that supposedly is holding the earth and the other planets circling the sun in their orbits. The answer that Isaac Newton came up with to solve the problem was gravity. And he said that gravity is holding the earth in its orbit, and it's also the force that's holding everything down to the earth. After all, if it wasn't that way, those people in Australia'd have some real problems, wouldn't they? But when you think about the idea of what they say gravity is, and you compute that into just the common sense that God gave us all, it doesn't make a lot of sense. There's no situation that can be repeated in any laboratory, on the earth or above the earth, where anything attracts something to itself the way they say gravity does. But it doesn't happen. Now, you might have static electricity that attracts things when you're pulling the dryer sheet apart, but that's not gravity. But if that wasn't foolish enough to think that water is held to a spinning ball spinning 1,000 miles an hour by some magical force, they say the air around you is spinning 1,000 miles per hour. Why would they even say something so absurd as the air around you is also spinning 1,000 miles per hour? And actually, if you think about it, if this is the earth, right at the earth it's spinning 1,000 miles per hour, but the higher you go in the atmosphere, the air has to be spinning faster than 1,000 miles per hour because the radius away from the center of the earth is getting farther and farther, which means the circle it has to make to keep up with the earth, it has to go faster than 1,000 miles per hour, the higher up you go. So why would they even say something so absurd that the air is somehow magically moving with the earth because of gravity? It's because if they don't say something so absurd, they have a real problem answering some real simple questions. The Illuminists promoting heliocentricity and gravity must get you to believe that gravity is also holding the atmosphere stuck to the spinning globe along with the water, because if not, how would they explain that a helicopter hovering in the air would come straight back down where it took off? After all, with the earth supposedly spinning 1,000 miles per hour, a helicopter would be able to take off, hover in place, and come back down 1,000 miles away without actually having to fly anywhere. The only way they can explain it is to say, well, the entire air and atmosphere around the earth is spinning with the earth, and that's why it's just carrying along the helicopter. How would they explain airplanes flying to destinations going both east and west? A commercial airplane flying the opposite direction of the earth's rotation would never be able to reach its destination, since the earth would always be spinning faster than the airplane could fly. And the higher you go, the faster the air would have to be spinning to keep up with the earth. We're told that the atmosphere sticks to the ball like the water sticks to the ball, because if you don't say that, you don't have a theory of gravity. And if you don't have a theory of gravity, you don't have any way to explain those orbits that the earth is supposedly making around the sun. And then all you're left with is, well, what the Bible said in the first place, that the earth is not moving and the sun's going around the earth instead. They do not want to admit that the earth is at the center, that the earth is not moving. Because if the earth is at the center and the earth is not moving, the earth is in a special place put here by someone. The whole Copernican system is intended to destroy the notion that the earth is in a special place for a special reason. If you don't want to believe that, you've got to come up with something to counter that. These are the theories they've created, and more theories to prop up those theories. Why? Because they don't want to acknowledge the God of the Bible. I'm almost through. Or maybe, just maybe, perhaps the earth isn't spinning or orbiting at all, but is fixed and cannot be moved, just like the Bible says. Now let's take a moment to review before we finish for the night. This goes back to what we looked at last week and brings us up to today. Science says the universe began with a big bang that included our sun. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says God created the heaven and the earth. Science says our solar system evolved over eons around the sun. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says God created everything in 6 days, and the earth was created before the sun. That was not created until day four. Science says the earth was created after the sun. We know it was created before the sun. Science says day and night originated from the sun. The Bible says day and night, the evening and the morning were the first day when God said, let there be light. There's been light since the first day. The sun didn't come around till day four. Science says plant life evolved because of the sun. And yet the Bible tells us God created the plants on day three. And the sun didn't come into existence till day four. No photosynthesis if you're counting on the sun to do it. Science says that the moon is not a light, but a reflector of the sun. Yet the Bible says in all the verses we looked at last week, the moon has her own light, which is a different light than the sun. Science says the earth is a spinning ball lit by the sun. But the Bible says the earth isn't the one that's moving. That it was the sun that stood still. That the sun is in a circuit. Science says the earth revolves around the sun. But the Bible says the earth moveth not. It is fixed and moves not. Do you detect any pattern here? How much of the above of what science says is congruent with the Bible? Are any of those statements on the board that science says, are any of them compatible with the Bible? They're not. They're all in complete disagreement with the Bible. Second question, or third question, what is the focus of modern cosmology? What is the one thing that you see in every single one of these scientific statements? What is the common denominator that all of modern cosmology is about? The sun. And it's the worship of the sun. NASA's not going to tell you that everything they're doing is to promote the worship of the sun, the moon, and the stars. But everything they do is to promote the worship of the sun, the moon, and the stars. Every other space agency in the world, every other astrophysicist you've seen as a talking head on television is not going to tell you that their goal is to get you to not believe the Bible, to not believe in the God of the Bible. But for those that were here several weeks ago when almost everybody else was out of town, we watched a video that showed some interviews with some of those big name astrophysicists when they were talking to their peers instead of network television. And every one of them, to a man, said, "Our goal is that we do not believe in God. God is foolishness." That's their motive. That's their agenda. "Preacher, this is all brand new. I'm going to have to take this in." Well, you got a whole week to take it in because I'm going to be bringing some more brand new stuff next Sunday. You can call me. You can text me. You can write me. You can do whatever you want to do. I'll stick around as long as you want to. But let me say this. You're getting all of this one thing right after another from me. I understand it's not easy to accept that everything you've been taught might be wrong. I've been there myself. Fortunately, I had the luxury of figuring it out for myself. And I didn't have someone showing me all these things one right after another. I had to kind of put it all together over several years. I hope you'll at least pray about it. Think about it. I'm not going to tell you what to believe. You believe whatever you want to believe. But if you're honest with the Scriptures, you can't believe any of those things that are listed on the screen up here. The Bible says something different. I hope you'll be back next week. There's some more to come, and it will be just as surprising to you as this. Now, I promised that I would take questions or comments at the end. I know I'm already over time, so if you need to go, you're welcome to go. But is there anyone that has any questions or observations you want to make about the material tonight? Not about other things, but about the material tonight.
Pictures of medieval cosmology, then you see not only the earth and the planets, but the outer sphere. Beyond that, you would have heaven. So that the earth was considered to be at rest, ultimately, with respect to heaven, with respect to the throne of God.
For 1500 years, Ptolemy's system was used as the basis of astronomy and calendars, and it worked quite well. But there were always those who detested its departure from the purely uniform, circular motion assumed to be perfect and appropriate for heavenly bodies. Among these was Nicolaus Copernicus.
Copernicus hated that. And Copernicus set about to undo Ptolemy's greatest discovery.
While working at the request of Pope Leo X on improvements to the Julian calendar, Copernicus conceived what turned out to be the foundational idea of modernity itself. The idea that the earth moved.
Copernicanism, in short, is a concept that is protected in a bunker under a 50-foot thick ceiling of solid scientific concrete. It is meant to be impregnable. It is a concept that has become ensconced in men's minds as the indestructible cornerstone of the Enlightenment, modern man's knowledge. Virtually all people everywhere have been taught to believe, and do believe, that this concept is based on objective science and dispassionate secular reasoning, now long since freed from religious superstitions based on the Bible. Indeed, it was the Copernican heliocentric concept that gradually broke the back of Bible credibility as the source of absolute truth in Christendom. Once the Copernican revolution had conquered the physical sciences of astronomy and physics and put down deep roots in universities and lower schools everywhere, it was only a matter of time until the biological sciences launched the Darwinian Revolution. Over three centuries of carefully layered propaganda and indoctrination had defeated and all but buried the Bible's account of a stationary Earth. The outer wall of the Bible's claim to truth had been battered down by radical members of the scientific priesthood, and now they were on the verge of breaking through the second line of defense with the evolution battering ram. This breakthrough was designed to defeat and bury not only the creation account of man created in the image of God, but the whole creation scenario set out in the Bible. No creation, no Garden of Eden, no Satan, no temptation, no fall, no need for Jesus to redeem from the fallen condition.
Not all were persuaded by Copernicus, however. The greatest astronomer of the time, Tycho Brahe, developed a new geocentric model. The Earth occupies the center, the planets orbit the Sun, and the Sun orbits the Earth.
Tycho Brahe, who is a great unsung hero of this, because he did an immense number of observations, very accurate ones, very precise for a long period of time.
Well, in the Tychonic geocentric system, the Sun is traveling around the Earth literally and carrying the planets with it. So the Sun is making the ecliptic, it's not the Earth.
Tycho hired a young assistant named Johannes Kepler in 1600. Kepler, working on his own development of the Copernican system, needed Tycho's observations, but Tycho refused to part with them. When Tycho died suddenly and mysteriously in 1601, Kepler took charge of Tycho's observations and used them to develop his own system.
Kepler's great insight was that the Sun must be playing a significant role in the motion of the planets. They are following very definite paths, we know that for sure. How on earth do they do it? And what moves them? So he said the Sun must be somehow causing them to go round. So he postulated that the Sun is rotating and had sort of spokes which somehow got weaker as you were further from the Sun.
In Kepler's system, the Sun is in the center while the planets move on ellipses, non-uniformly. The ellipse, with its two foci, allows us to see that Ptolemy's epicycles and equant were actually a brilliant attempt to express non-uniform motion centuries before Kepler. Indeed, once the concept of non-uniform motion is introduced, all of these systems can be shown to be geometrically identical. It was Kepler's idea that the Sun must somehow be moving the planets in their orbits that set the stage for Isaac Newton's great breakthroughs. But observational tools equal to the task would first have to be developed.
Science has found evidence that Earth is the center of the universe. Science has found evidence that God exists. So why do they tell us we are insignificant?
There's nothing special about humans. There's nothing special about the Earth. In fact, our universe may be one among many universes.
And there's no evidence of planning or purpose in the universe.
The Big Bang assumes that the only thing that exists is the physical world, and there's nothing beyond that.
The truth is, we are significant.
We are in a special place. I do believe that the universe was created by God.
Always question the scientists and their foundations.
They built their careers on this, and it would be admitting a major mistake.
So they set up a satellite, and they find out these temperature disturbances throughout the universe were all pointing to the Earth.
Whoa, what is going on here?
This cosmic microwave background is like we are seeing the fingerprint of God, the hallmarks of the Creator.
Man is in a special location for presumably a special purpose.
When I see how barren the other planets are and how bountiful the Earth is, something's different, and we're in just the right spot for it.
We are in a special place. I do believe that.
Science has said, stay over in this category here, and you cannot go into the God category, because that's going to destroy our science.
Now, that is controversial, because anyone in the standard cosmology community would not even entertain such a notion.
It's just too perfect to be a happenstance or a coincidence.
This is the movie Modern Science Doesn't Want You to See.
If you were paranoid, you'd say there's a conspiracy.
As a matter of fact, you can go on some websites of NASA and see that they've started to take down stuff that might hint to a geocentric universe. I mean, how do you avoid this evidence?
They have nowhere to go. It's the moment of truth for science.
So, I'm keeping all options on the table.
You are significant.